Simon & Schuster Audio presents On Ocean Boulevard by Mary Alice Monroe. Read by Cassandra Campbell.
To Sally Murphy, Kelly Thorvaldson, and Kevin Mills. The team at the South Carolina Aquarium, the Island Turtle Team, the team at the SCDNR Sea Turtle Conservation Program. Thank you, mentors, friends, teammates, and fellow turtle lovers. Odyssey. The sea is thick and murky. Can you see me? I am propelled forward, swept in spiraling swift water. The great current carries me. It writhes along the coastline, swirls around the great gyre, churns past vast sargassum weed. The current snakes from south to north, a supernatural force pushing me forward, always onward. I am a loggerhead. I've journeyed far in this vast ocean, servant to my magnetic compass. Now a voice calls to me in the current. It is the voice of my ancestors, an instinct that has guided mothers generation after generation for 200 million years. I heed the call. I spread my beautiful flippers as strange forces gain strength in my soul, compelling me westward. Light shimmers above, then grows dark. Aqua to indigo, over and over on this odyssey. Hunger gnaws at my belly as I swim through the broth of drifting plankton. I push past gangly, gliding invertebrates, beyond the wreck fish and sea bream that share space beneath a gilt rock laden with pink coral and bright anemones. I am riding a river of current, sliding in watery thermals warmed by the sun, powered by the Earth's rotation. I am soaring through liquid wind, returning to the beach of my birth. I am swimming, swimming, swimming home. Mary Alice Monroe. Chapter 1. The Low Country, also known as the Low Country, is, as the name implies, a low-lying area along the South Carolina Atlantic coast. This area is rich with unique culture, geography, architecture, economy, cuisine, and stories. The Low Country was spread out far below as she soared in the sky. Linnea Rutledge sighed and placed her fingertips on the plane's cool window, her eyes tracing the twisting creeks and winding rivers that snaked through the seemingly impenetrable greenery of the salt marsh. From her vantage point, the rivers looked like great arteries, and all the myriad creeks were veins. Salt water coursed through them like a bloodstream. The tides were the Low Country's pumping heart. As the plane descended, bringing the landscape closer and closer, Linnea felt that salt water thrumming in her own veins, as it did for all who called the Low Country home. Her connection to the landscape and its crown jewel, Charleston, was as vital as an umbilical cord. She should be happy returning to her home, her family, her friends. Instead, she felt demoralized, a failure both professionally and personally. 2 years earlier, Linnea had headed west into a great show of independence. She'd won out over hundreds of applicants for a job with an environmental startup company in San Francisco. To add to her status, she was accompanied by her new beau, defying her parents and convinced she was in love, only to lose her job and be dumped by her boyfriend. She wasn't sure which she was more embarrassed about, losing her job or losing her boyfriend, or just returning home with her tail between her legs. Linnea had visited only 3 times during her 2 years away, twice for Christmas and once for the wedding of a friend. She liked San Francisco. The great city by the Pacific was a thriving, beautiful, intellectually stimulating place. But she'd been homesick for the Atlantic Ocean, for the slower pace of Charleston with its southern culture, its rich history, the narrow cobblestone streets she knew by heart, the weather-washed pastel colors of the old South, the clip-clop of horse carriages, and the smell of jasmine surprising you as you walked past a walled garden. And the food. Barbecue and sweet tea, collards and shrimp. Her empty stomach growled at the thought. Her ex-boyfriend, John Peterson, had accompanied her home each time. A southern boy himself, he'd spent his summers on Isle of Palms, and was always glad to join her and visit his childhood friends, and of course, his mother, Emmy Baker. She was her Aunt Cara's best friend and neighbor. Linnea and John used to laugh that their relationship had seemed almost incestuous. But John was always antsy to head back to the West Coast. That's where he'd made his home and planned to stay. They'd still been deep in the throes of romance when attending the Charleston wedding the previous summer. Linnea had watched the bride walk down the aisle, then looked up at John dreamily. Her first clue should have been that he wasn't looking back at her. The plane landed with a graceless thump, bounced, then glided down the runway to a stop. En masse, the sound of clicking seatbelts filled the air as passengers reached for their phones. Linnea's legs felt wobbly as she dragged her carry-on suitcase into the terminal. She craved a bathroom, a face wash, and strong coffee in that order. Her reflection in the mirror made her burst out a quick laugh. Her eyes were puffy from tears and lack of sleep, her skin chalky, and her shoulder-length blonde hair was falling out of the tenuous hold of a scrunchie. The neighboring sinks were being used by women with the same idea as her. Digging into her large bag, she pulled out supplies. She splashed her face with cool water, then quickly ran a toothbrush across her teeth and a hairbrush through her hair. She applied moisturizer, a quick stroke of blush and lip gloss, then reassessed herself. She'd always been considered pretty in the classic Southern Belle style, with her small stature, blonde hair, and blue eyes, a clone of her grandmother, Olivia Rutledge, a comparison that pleased her. Her Charleston accent was delicately Southern, her social manners deeply ingrained. Today, however, even after her quick primp, she looked tired, a bit ragged around the edges. Her retro 1940s high-waisted capris were wrinkled from the long plane flight. At least her nautical striped top still looked fresh. She adjusted the navy bow. Oh well, she thought, turning away from the mirror. She didn't have anyone to impress. Stepping outside the airport's glass sliding doors, Linnea paused and took deep breaths of the April air. It felt moist and delicious. Everything was so fresh and green here. She lifted her face to the sun, relieved and grateful to be out of the cramped, stuffy airplane and the staleness of airport terminals. She could feel her pores open under the sunlight and her cells tingle. A rush of excitement flowed through her. She was home. In a few months' time, summer would descend and the scorching heat and humidity would be unbearable. The mosquitoes beastly. But now everything felt heavenly. A shiny black Hyundai pulled up to the curb in front of her. Linnea checked the model and license plate against the order on her phone. It wasn't a fancy car, but opening the door, she saw that it was roomy and obviously well-tended by the middle-aged man driving it. A bottle of chilled water had been thoughtfully placed in the back seat, as well as a Charleston magazine, though a few months old, with curling edges. She made a mental note to leave a generous tip for the effort. She leaned back against the cushion with a weary sigh. Now all she had to do was sit, and she'd be home. The car accelerated and she smiled. She was on her way to Sullivan's Island. The address she'd given the driver had felt strange on her tongue. It was the first time she'd come home since her family had sold the house in Charleston. Linnea had been born and raised in the Rutledge house on Trad Street. The lovely Charleston single with the two-story piazza had been purchased by her grandparents, then handed down to her father. The stately home was within walking distance of Charleston Harbor and had an impressive walled garden. The garden had been her grandmother Lovey's passion. and been included in the city's garden tours for years. Trad Street was named for Robert Trad, the first white child to be born in Charlestown. Names were important in Charleston, more important than the address where one lived. Linnea's father, Palmer, was a Rutledge, one of the great historic families of the Old South. Even today, the names Rutledge, Middleton, Ujere, Pinckney, Trad, Calhoun, Legree, Ball, and Pringle raised eyebrows. These great names were passed down from one generation to another, heavy with hyphens. She'd been given the name Linnea Lee Rutledge. Her brother was Cooper Pringle Rutledge. Many of her friends had some combination of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.